morning, South Africa, and welcome to it. This is the weekend edition right here on SABC 3, and I am Khanyi, the girl that you wake up with every morning. This is it, and these are my guests. Welcome to the show, guys.
Yes.
Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you. Introduce yourselves quickly. You are?
My name is Vusi Nova, musician.
I'm Beyile, Mr. Studio Girl.
Loki Rothman, also musician.
What's happening, Joe? Good morning, darling.
I'm getting hungry, man. It's Saturday morning, and that's one of the displeasures of doing this show is that you get bombarded with all this wonderful food. I want to eat now. I'm one half of your hosts, Phat Joe. This is Suan.
Hey,
Ellen. Welcome back to the Weekend Edition.
Good to be here.
And of course, Daniel Ting Chong, right?
Yeah, got it.
Love the name. He's a designer. You run your own business, right?
Yes, I'm an independent graphic designer and illustrator.
Award-winning graphic designer.
Apparently so.
And I've seen some of your work. We're going to show you some of his work. Absolutely incredible. Thank you for coming on to the show. Suan, what's going on here? Like, can we eat now? Is this breakfast?
I'm gonna make sure you're fed soon. Let me put it that way. We want to keep everything sexy. So how do we take simple things, make them at home,
okay,
and then make them look even more delicious than they taste? They say you eat with your eyes first.
Now, you know, if you join us every weekend, we kick it all off with a performance. Today, we've got an amazing performance from Vusi Nova, taking off his current album, Na Nini Na. Here is Tandiwe.
Tandiwe, 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 kwasekuqaleni wangu Tandiwe, ningafuni nokubuva. Anfuna ukuphila ngaphandle kwakho Tandiwe
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 Time.
Wow, man. Wow, girl. You need to clean up, girl. She is touched by the music. Now, we need to take a short break. We'll be back with some more of the Weekend Edition. Make sure you check us out on our social media. What are our social media tags again?
It is Facebook, The Weekend Edition, and on Twitter, The Weekend on 3. Let us know, and the hashtag is The Weekend Edition. Let's go to a break. I'm trying to catch my breath. I'm touched.
Vusi, you need to cut this out. It's a weekend.
Welcome back, and you're watching The Weekend Edition right here on 3. There are only a few people in this industry that I can honestly say deserve a break. I know many people are talented and everyone deserves a chance, but there are certain individuals that work their way up in a way that they deserve to be where they are. And that is the guy sitting on the couch who just performed such a beautiful song that got me into tears.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you.
Vusi, it's so good to see you. Look, I know you personally.
Yeah.
Beyond the work that we do.
Yeah.
You're like a brother to me. You're like a husband. You're like all that. Because you know my pains. You know my wishes and ambitions. You're one person who knows who we are. You've come a long way.
We did a musical together.
Yes. Yeah. School days. Live it up. Yes.
Yeah, yeah.
Wow. You've come a long way.
It's been very long. I mean, I don't remember a time where I wasn't singing.
Yeah.
When, so music has always been a passion of mine from the time singing, and this is what I'm going to die doing.
Look, you've spoken about where you came from, why you chose music.
Yeah.
But now your new direction, there's an aura about you that I'm getting of being content, of being at a place where you're now, you've closed that chapter and you've said to yourself, look, what happened happened, this is who I am, deal. Where does it come from?
I think it's got a lot to do with growing up and understanding and accepting that guso, and it's not going to change.
Mm.
The only person that can change that is myself, you know. And that's why umculo for me, you know, umculo helps me through so many things. Mm. Whatever I go through, difaga in the studio and I just record. That's what I do.
That's amazing. That's amazing. Look, you've worked with a lot of artists in South Africa.
A lot.
You've helped guide a lot of artists, as much as they may not say that, but you've always been the voice in a lot of people's careers, like your Kwela Debzas, the group of three men,
Muzo.
Imuzo.
Yeah.
And you're now friends with Nat, and you perform with him as well.
Yeah.
How does that feel, and how do you see how the face of music has changed?
You know, I think as a country,
we're
taking steps in the right direction. When I feel like the quality, like the production these days is amazing. The artists these days, I think we're going back to the olden days because I feel like, you know?
Mm.
And we're going back to that. You know, when it comes to Nati, Unati is just, wow. I think he's inspired me in so many ways. I mean, I remember when I first met Unati, I actually heard a song of his, Unomvula. They were playing it at the office. And I listened to this song and I was like, wow. I moved over to this guy and I was like, who is this guy? He was like, Unati. From where? Eastern Cape. You know? And I said, we need to get a hold of this guy. And he was like, I've got the number. And I was like, Mazumfonele. I called him. He couldn't believe it, obviously, that I was calling him. And I made him a promise and I said, I'm going to make sure that you are in Joburg this month, this week, actually, and people are going to hear of you. Look at him today.
You know, the love that you have is so deep, and personally, I know that people may not know about this, but you've always said it was love that your mom had given you, and that's why you're such a lover. Even in your music, you're such a lover.
I was given too much love.
You know?
So all I'm doing is sharing it with the rest of the world. That's what it is.
I'd like to speak about your mom because, you know, a lot of people, I always tell them that your mom was a fun person. She was a party starter.
Yeah,
the fashion, the style, the music that you sing. Because, I mean, you've got the soulful, closer vibe to your music.
Yeah, yeah.
Tell me about that.
So I moved to Joburg when I was about 14. And when I got here, my mom was crazy over soul.
Yes.
Motown.
Yes.
And I fell in love with it, and I said to myself, this is what I want to do. You know, she's always inspired me, motivated me to chase my dream. Like, she's always known that umntana mufuna ukula. And not one day did she say to me, ha-ah, yeah, get on the level. She was just there all the time. You know, I feel like, and that's why, for example, when Walking to Light came out,
yes.
I'd Rather Go Blind.
Yes.
That was one of her favorite songs.
Yes.
You know? So after she passed on, I thought, let me do something for her. Even that song, it wasn't supposed to be a single. You know, it was just supposed to be any ngoma in the album.
Mm.
But people loved the song, and I guess people know of me because of that song.
Will you ever let it loose? Because I don't know if people know how crazy you are on stage, how you go wild, and you've got that dancehall flavor to you. Are you ever going to release something like that? Do you ever go crazy on stage and show that side? Yeah,
I do, actually. I do now, like, actually, all the time. Whenever I perform,
yes.
You know, this is who I am. You know, I went to school for this thing. I always say to people, I want to be known as one of the best singers ever. You know, and I'm working towards that. I'm still working towards that.
Five best singers of all time, without thinking about it.
Of all time?
Yes.
R. Kelly.
Yes.
Ringo.
Yevo.
Brenda Fassie.
Hey.
Marvin Gaye. Definitely Michael Jackson.
All right. If you had to host a lunch, what would you feed them?
Simple, umngqusho.
Keeping it local.
Yeah, umngqusho nomathambo.
Is that what you're gonna have?
Yeah, definitely.
Well, after the break, we're getting into an eating insert. Do you cook?
Do you guys?
Do you cook? Do you get your fingers
dirty? I'm very bad at cooking. I can certainly try.
Okay.
But I'm not. No. I don't know.
So if I had to put you in a challenge and say I'll put you in the kitchen with Joe, would you be able to handle the heat?
Can Joe cook?
Yo, Joe cooks. He's got a mean curry, and I know he's supposed to say it, but it's a curry that can take down any curry master. Anyway.
Joe, you're on.
More fire.
You're on. It's on.
So after the break, we go into the kitchen, and there's much, much more coming from Vusi Nova. Don't move an inch. It's a weekend.
Welcome back to the weekend edition, Saturday morning edition. Now, my next guest is Daniel Ting Chong. We'll talk about the name. He's an illustrator, designer, and artist. He's also an emerging superstar as one of South Africa's top creative talents following a series of art exhibitions, talks, commissions, and design collaborations. I know that's a mouthful, with leading international brands. He's also named on the list of the top 200 young South Africans. I never made that list. Welcome.
I was very lucky.
Yeah, when was this? What year was that?
Mail and Guardian, I think it was 2 years ago.
When they put you in that list, like, what do they tell you? Do they tell you that, listen, is it like an Illuminati initiation? Like, are you guaranteed future success?
Where's the check coming from? Like,
right.
I'm waiting for it. But they just sent me a mail to say you've been nominated. And
right.
And I was very honored.
There you go, man. One of our other guests today was put in the Forbes Future Millionaires list. So,
That's crazy.
I've never been in any. So congratulations.
Thank you.
But you're a designer, illustrator, and artist. When you explain to your mom what you do in plain English, what do you do?
I think the easiest thing to explain to like my mom would just be like, I make pictures, and then it kind of helps brands kind of grow.
Does she believe you have a real job? Like,
yeah, she just thinks I sit in front of the computer and kind of put like shapes together or something like that.
Now Daniel, talking about your work, just so that people understand, let's talk about a couple of your pieces. Like, what are, for you, from your most recent works, what are you most proud of, or what are you most excited about?
Yeah, I mean, there's lots of projects that I definitely appreciate. My work kind of splits between local and international work, but I think it's always kind of really nice to kind of add value back into South Africa. So
yeah.
A local project that I just finished like in the last little while ago was Mr. Big Stuff, which is a restaurant in Bramfontein, where they serve kind of American diner burgers, your fried chicken and waffles.
I think I've seen it. Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Okay, and walk us through the design, because it looks quite eclectic or very abstract.
The client was awesome. They wanted something that was kind of Japanese inspired with American diner type of feel. Mm. So we, it's called Mr. Big Stuff. So we kind of made a symbol with a really happy face, just as a kind of a light-hearted feel. So when you walk into the space, you feel quite relaxed, and the food is quite ridiculous in terms of like fried chicken and waffles. Sounds a bit like outrageous, but so they wanted to kind of bring that tonality through the actual branding itself.
Okay.
So we used quite a bright color palette of pastels, and we used that kind of on the tabletops and furniture. And even the packaging and stuff, we used the face in a lot of different scenarios. And the staff members had the face on big t-shirts and hoodies, and they wear 5-panel caps, so they always look good.
Wow.
Yeah, so it was really fun,
That is cool, man. So design work is not just doing a simple logo. There's quite a lot of elements.
Yeah, so it's not just a picture, basically. Yeah. It's like you got to consider what obviously your client needs, but specifically for a restaurant, you need like a logo, signage, what would the website, packaging.
You mentioned shirts, hats.
What do the utensils look like that you eat with? Like, do you consider that? Or even the napkin. So like, for instance, one of the ideas that we didn't go with, but that we did consider was maybe the napkin has like the face.
Yeah.
Pronounce it, if you would wipe your face, you would kind of have the smile of Mr. Big Stuff.
Got you.
Yeah.
Is there a lot of money in design?
I think it depends how good you want to be, I don't think money should be like the ultimate goal, but I think you should try and improve as a creative person, and money would just be a byproduct of your kind of hard work.
Right. Yeah. Okay, so you're South African, right?
I'm actually second generation South African.
Okay, because your name is Daniel, and then Ting Chong, is that middle name and surname, or is Ting Chong your surname?
Ting Chong is it's a double barrel surname, but like, it's actually my grandfather, that was his like first and second name. But when he came down, there was like a lot of confusion with his name, with the government and stuff. So they ended up using that as like his surname.
Name. Right.
And it's meant to be like, grammatically, there's meant to be a hyphen between Ting and Chong to show that it's joint, but there isn't. So
in your ID, there's
so it's a nightmare sometimes.
And what does it mean? And what's the origin? What country is that from?
From China.
Okay, so it's a Chinese, is it Mandarin?
Yeah.
Okay, so it's a Chinese surname. What does it mean?
I actually don't entirely show it in you, because that's his first.
He's so South African.
Chief.
It's like my name. I don't know what it means either.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But when I was younger, I couldn't really speak English properly. And then I had to go to, because I used to speak Hakka, which is like another older dialect of Mandarin.
Okay.
And then I went to English school and I kind of substituted the one language for the other, which is kind of.
Hold on. You said you're second or third generation?
Second generation South African.
Okay, your parents are South African.
Yeah, so they were born in Port Elizabeth, which is crazy.
You can speak.
And they can speak fluent Afrikaans and Khoza. It's pretty impressive.
Wow,
Daniel,
okay.
How old are you? You look 14.
14, that's a good thing, I'm 28.
What? That's nice.
Yeah, he's not aging at all, man.
Well, Vusi's also from PE, so.
Must be that gene or something coming from.
Where in PE are you from?
Well, my parents were born in PE in Kabiga, but I was born in Cape Town.
Okay, it ring a bell anywhere near there?
Yeah, I know it very well.
Yeah?
Very
okay,
well.
There you go. Hey. Wow, man, that's incredible. Okay, so I want to talk about design. People don't realize this, but just like with music or even filmography, is that even a word? There's always fashion trends in like design work. So currently, what is the trend in the design? And like, if I want to create a corporate logo or if I want to design something, what should I be looking for? What is in trend right now?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's kind of bad to follow trends, especially for brands, because then you kind of end up looking like the next guy.
Right.
So it depends what the nature of your business is, what would be suitable for you. So if you're like in the food industry or you're a musician, you would have a different look. But I think the foundation for any good design is that it's just strong, and then it will last a long time. Because I think with trends, they die out. So like, let's just say if you have a logo for Joe, and we make it like super trendy, once the trend dies, your brand will look
right,
bad.
Right.
So you want to make something that
timeless
and has longevity. Yeah.
Okay. All right. So it depends on the utility and purpose
for the
design work. And then just real quick, when you're not designing, what do you do?
Funny enough, I play for a local basketball team in Cape Town.
You don't play basketball.
No way.
Get out of here.
No way. Never.
So with
you mean netball, right? You play netball. You play for a basketball team.
Yeah. So even with my height, I play like a point guard position. So
it would
be like a Chris Paul kind of like height. It's not as like tall as like Kevin Durant or LeBron or something. So my spare time, I spend a lot of time on the courts.
Have you got good handles? Like,
Yeah, you gotta work. You gotta work your hands and stuff.
No, I don't believe it.
We can go to the court. We can play. See how it goes.
Get out of here. Like, you serious? Yeah. Like, you looked you down.
I know.
And do you get a lot of design ideas while you're playing ball and stuff like that?
Yeah. I think it helps to do stuff outside of your actual occupation, which kind of influences the way that you think or add value to your ideas.
Right.
But also, like, when you're super stressed out with work, it's like the best thing to kind of just go on the courts.
Right.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I want to take you to a place which I know you've never been to, which is the Museum of African Design in Joburg. You've never been there, right?
Yeah, I've never been.
All right. Well, check this out. This is a celebration of all things Afrocentric. The Museum of African Design is an exciting addition to downtown Joburg and the perfect spot to visit on a weekend or a date. Constantly changing exhibitions from photographers to artists, sculptors, and even architects. This is a dynamic and exciting space that changes each time you visit. Take a look at this.
Another jewel in Joburg's Maboneng neighborhood is an Art Deco building, which is home to the Museum of African Design.
The MoDe is the first museum of African design on the continent. It's about 3 years old, but we decided to use this 90-year-old building from a mining company that manufactured generators, cables, all kinds of supplies for the mining industry back in the 1930s.
Rather than being a collecting institution, MoDe is a cultural hub and mirrors the dynamic world of African design in diverse options for visitors.
So the museum is not a typical museum in the sense that there's a collection here and that there's always the same things to see. It's always changing. And so we really consider the museum as a resource for design. So whether you're a student learning about what design thinking is and about problem solving and about what designers can do for the world, or if you're a professional designer and you want to learn a new skill, we have workshops, resources, and materials available here so that you can really use the museum as a place to learn new things.
Because of its location in an area which has broken new ground in urban renewal, the museum's exterior and interior attract curious visitors, both local and international.
Being in downtown Johannesburg is really special, and especially within the Maboneng precinct, because this is not a new neighborhood starting from scratch. This is a redeveloped part of the city that has lots of buildings from the 1930s, 1940s, 1950s, and so it really is a design challenge.
The museum wants to be a place for conversation, research, and response to the issues of African design from all over the continent in an environment that's accessible to everyone.
I think a lot of people assume that museums have collections, and that's sort of a changing debate in the museum world. But for right now, we want to be exhibiting the most exciting things from around the continent. So the museum is not about South Africa, it's not about Johannesburg, it's about the continent at large and what is going on in design. And then there's still so much to explore that we want to not spend money buying and storing and insuring and preserving, but to actually bring new things and new ideas to the public.
The latest exhibition is one where the art changes daily as artists and designers must express their view on the social emergencies of that day.
The exhibition that we've had for the last few weeks is based on a concept called the emergency room. And basically, what role does art have in current events? What social impact can art have? And so artists and designers from around the world have come here, and every day they've presented something new about an emergency that they've seen in society. Normally when we have an exhibition, we know exactly what's going to happen, exactly what's going to be on display. But what's really special about the emergency room and what took place here is that art had to be created the same day that it was exhibited to try to sort of suss out whether or not art can make a difference and whether artists can comment on what's going on in society.
Artists have free rein with how they'd like to present their emergency. Some are elaborate and thought-provoking, while others opt for striking simplicity.
Each of the artists in the exhibition had to present an emergency that they felt was important to them. Victor Ash, who's a really well-known European street artist and muralist, was one of the visiting artists, and on this day he chose elephant poaching because in the news was a lot of talk about ivory and the extinction of elephants in East Africa and how populations are being treated. And so his response was to use spray paint and these bags, which he found at a market in Johannesburg, as a way to show people that this is what he felt was important on that day. This photo collage from June 23rd was done by Jody Bieber, and she's an award-winning photojournalist. She goes to war zones and covers events around the world and lives here in Johannesburg. And instead of being behind the camera and having this really sort of narrative experience of being embedded in the field or doing assignments, she had to come up with something immediately. And so she worked in a totally different medium, taking these news clippings and Instagram images of the emergencies of the day. So this is a picture of what was going on in the world at that moment.
By changing the perception of museums, this is the perfect weekend spot for everyone to have a truly engaging experience to see how culture and the world of art and design exist harmoniously together.
So on Monday morning, you have no excuse to tell anybody you had nothing to do with places like that museum where you could take your friends and loved ones. Let's keep the conversation going right here on the show to tell us what you think, what you like, what you want to see. It's on Facebook, The Weekend Edition, and on Twitter and Instagram, Weekend on 3. Hashtag us, The Weekend Edition. Send videos. Tell us what you'd like to eat, what you'd like to see, who we should bring, and what Joe should wear. After the break, we talk to Sue Ann about making food sexy like me. See you now.
Welcome back to The Weekend Edition. We've got the whole squad here. We're getting ready to, well, minus Dan. Are you okay over there?
No, I'm
all
fine,
right,
thank
cool.
You.
We're gonna cook some food for you, all right. Sue Ann is here. We're gonna make a lovely breakfast, right?
We are. We're doing a homemade granola.
Okay, with, I love granola.
You do.
I love granola.
But homemade granola, I believe everything that's fresh and homemade always tastes better.
Yes.
So easy to do. Don't spend tons of money buying a homemade bag off a shelf, do it yourself.
I know, because when I buy the granola, it's like five
says
servings,
homemade.
100 rand a little pack.
It's quite expensive.
So I want to know how to make a granola, so let's
nice
do this.
Thing about making it at home, I mean, you need some rolled oats, so that's pretty simple. It's going to go
in
your bowl.
What are rolled oats, by the way? It's such a fancy name. Do they really, like, roll them? Like, what is it?
Am I allowed to say? I don't know what the exact process is.
Nobody knows.
It to the box.
Nobody
right.
knows.
It's okay. One of those things. No. It's one of
rolled
those
oats, okay? Rolled oats. It's oats. These are the oats that you would cook if you were making, you know, a bowl of the good old stuff back in the
porridge,
day.
With
milk,
yeah.
A porridge. So we want rolled oats. So these are our raw, so we can still toast them. I am going to use some flaked almonds. Thank you.
Is it true you can put pretty much anything into granola? So this is just
That's
your preferred
exactly
ingredients.
It. Okay. My preferred ingredients. You were talking about cost. If you're wanting to keep cost low and you just wanted to do some grated orange rind, for example,
yeah,
just to get that beautiful flavor, you could just add that. So it really is what your heart desires. So I'm going to use a selection of two nuts, cashews and almonds, and some dried cranberries.
Mm.
I love the sweetness, but also color. So when these goes into the jar, it's going to look beautiful. We also need some olive oil.
Right.
So we're going to get that in. It's going to prevent it from all clumping and sticking because we are going to need to add an additional sweetener to this. Thank
and
you.
And also a quick question. As someone who likes to go to gym, is this a good source of protein?
Look, you've got quite a lot of protein here with all of your nuts. So absolutely, you don't need to add an additional meat protein to this. Also, when we layer it, there's yogurt as well. So absolutely.
Is there a lot of calories in this? I think that's probably part of the question as well. Is it?
Yeah. What are you most concerned with? Calories.
Calories.
Yeah. Of course he is. He goes to gym.
This is Sue adding the maple syrup because she
so this
likes
is where the calories
sweet
come
and crunchy.
From.
You're going to get most of your calories, obviously, from whatever sweetener it is, so whether it's honey or your maple syrup. But if you look at this big bowl, I mean, I don't know about you guys, but when I'm adding yogurt and I'm adding something else, I use such a small portion of this to actually really satiate you. So it depends.
It's got a great low GI component, but
absolutely,
I don't know.
It's gonna
I
keep
suspect
you going.
That granolas are caloric. Like, you can get fat off of granola, can't you?
I think so.
Depends on what else you're eating through your day. You know, balance out every meal that you have. I think it's like that with everything. If you're eating healthy food, but you're eating like 3,000 calories worth of healthy food, is it healthy food?
Yeah.
Not really. So what's your energy intake versus output?
All right.
So onto a baking sheet.
Do
all
it,
of this
is it non-stick
good stuff,
or?
And this is a non-stick one. If you are worried, a little bit of some non-stick spray onto your sheet, but we're just going to get in there. You want to make it into just the best sous chef today.
Yeah.
Amazing. Thin layer. This is going to go into the oven at 180 degrees, 8 minutes. We're going to take it out, give it a toss, make sure that it's nice and evenly browned. In for another 8 minutes, Bob's your uncle. So I'm going to do that And then I've got toasted coconut flakes to add.
You show
at
off.
At the
you.
End.
I like those are sexy food, and they like fresh yeah. coconuts.
See, it's sexy.
I didn't cook, so I'm learning.
That's
I'm
gonna
learning.
Go in. So
that's
we've
good.
Got,
yeah.
got another batch minutes. Going. Yeah. So 8 minutes, take it out, toss, another 8 minutes, and that's done. This is what the final product is going to look like. So toasty brown. You can see what that oil does, so it doesn't stick.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
It's beautiful. So calorie question, how much are you gonna have? I think because of that, I'm gonna start with a little jar of this jar
that's
for you.
Portion, okay, yeah.
Cool. actually wanna start with some of the granola. So best to spoon it in here. So we
looks
want
fantastic.
A layer of this.
And she's maple syrup, not maple flavored syrup.
Maple
syrup.
Syrup.
A lot of you guys go to the grocery store and you get the flavored stuff and it's just sugar cane.
You
want
to add a nice lashing of yogurt to the top of that.
Lashing.
You're going to do the
deal. You see, this is why it's sexy food. And then I've made some coolie. So coolie, by definition, is just a thick sauce made of either fruit
it's
or veg.
It's not an insult. It's a dish, right?
Yeah, you see, it's French. No, love, sexy. There we go. But this can be store bought. So if you like. And one that's more citrus, if you want one that's purely blueberries. Yeah. These are mixed berries, and it's fruit, sugar, water, reduce it down
fruit,
in a pear.
Sugar, water, any fruit. It could be strawberries,
it can be strawberries, you can
cranberries, whatever.
100%.
Fruit, sugar, water, that's a coolie.
That's a coolie. And then this is gonna go on top.
Ooh. Right? Starting nice. To.
So we want to layer this. If we are using a bigger jar, you would just do layers all the way up. We're going to close, pop that on, and then you can take some ribbon, you can do whatever you like. Beautiful
but,
little
but
wooden
so you
spoons.
Know, I always ask you the question of you don't have this at home.
If you don't
you
have a jar
those.
At home.
Yeah, but you don't have it at home.
So the whole thing with sexy food is, you know, if the ladies are coming around for breakfast, oh, you want to impress
or your
the
man
dumb,
is coming.
Right? You've got to go and get it.
Me.
Sure.
I'm going to have something ready for you.
They're going to be using that tip now. Baby, come over for breakfast.
It's a good question. If
and
I don't,
bring
if,
it out.
If I don't have a jar, what am I going to do? I would use a bowl that's kind of got a wider base. I'd put some beautiful granola at the bottom, a smaller pile of the yogurt and the coolie on top, so you're still seeing the layers of the food. That's really the intention. You want to see every component of it. And then we want to take some ribbon.
I love the presentation. This is great, especially if you want to surprise your man and take him on a picnic. Mm.
Guys, exactly.
You girl, where
it,
are we
you
going?
Can, you can make
really?
It before. Where do you want to go, Joe?
Yeah.
Am I allowed to ask that? I don't know.
Girl,
I don't know.
You show me that, I'll be like, wherever you want to go.
You're doing it now.
I'm going to show off. I can tell you now.
Let's see if I can get another knot in here.
But guys do this the first week. After 3 months, it stops. It's a normal dish.
That is not true.
It's not true at all.
You've been dating the wrong men.
When they first meet you, it's like this. Then when you start asking for things like
this,
it's like,
wow.
So cute.
Can I just eat this right now?
I'm starving.
All right, no. We're building a meal.
We're building a meal. Joe is feeling some type of
while you guys are humming and hawing about the food, me and Khanyi thought we'd play a little game. What's the name of the game?
The name of the game is Sink. Float, would you rather sink, float, or drown? So we give you three candidates and you need to tell us who's sinking,
who would you sink,
who's floating, and who's drowning, and you have a boat. So,
you're on
the
boat. You can only take one person, you've got a floaty on you, three people are in the water, you have to save, you can save one,
put
you can give one a floaty,
him.
And then the other one must drown.
Wow, okay.
All right, you ready?
Yeah.
We're gonna leave you out of this, all right? Because you've prepared this wonderful meal.
I'm sure you came up with this, right?
No!
This sounds like Kanye's idea, though.
This is her dirty idea.
Yeah.
It sounds like Joe. Okay, all right.
Can we drown ourselves and let them
whatever you want to do.
Whatever you want to do.
Well, one person's going to drown with you if you do that.
That's the thing.
Yeah, somebody has to drown.
We jump off naked on.
No.
Then we good humans.
I'm gonna give you three names. Pearl Tusi.
Zanzang.
Yes.
DJ Zintle.
Zanzang.
Bonang.
Ding, 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 ding.
No, this is not fair.
See ya.
Look at him turn on the fist.
Okay, 30 seconds.
Bonang Zintle and?
And Pearl Tusi.
I'm gonna cut it off.
30 seconds.
Okay, they want you to start.
No.
And you cannot abstain.
Sorry, say again?
You can't abstain.
You have to. You have to.
Oh, no.
No,
no, you can't. You need
I'm
to.
I'm lost. So. Eh?
No, no.
Okay, I'm definitely saving Zintle.
Okay.
In the boat.
Yeah, gorgeous. Okay.
All right.
Pearl Tusi, Wanang. I mean, Pearl Tusi is going to be an international superstar now, and I'm a stylist, so it's, I can't let her drown. Okay. You know, I need the business. So let's say,
right.
This is business wise as well. So yeah. I'll float Pearl Tusi.
Yeah.
And I mean, we all know who's drowning.
All right, Vusi, what about you? Yeah?
In the and boat then? With you.
Yeah.
And? Yeah? Who gets a lifeboat?
Oh, my goodness.
The life jacket.
A floaty.
Floaty.
Pearl.
So is Zintle.
Zintle drowns.
She's wearing a watch.
You said it. I didn't
How
say
do you
so.
Drown her? She's wearing a watch.
Wow.
Zintle is wearing a watch. How do you drown someone with a watch?
I didn't say it. You said it. I didn't say it.
Someone's mother with a watch on.
Family.
And mother with a watch. And a girl can stand the water because her hair is curly naturally. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But you hear what he said?
What did he say? Huh?
You hear what he said?
Are you with him? So
oh
someone's mom, you're gonna drown someone's mother?
Someone's mother.
Wearing a watch?
I don't know. So that daughter was not...
So Zintle is drowning?
Look, I think this was fair. It's a nice balance. A nice
it
balance.
Was a difficult question, and thank you guys.
But who would you drown?
Yeah, there you go.
All right, coming up after this, the weekend edition continues. We'll be right back. Back to Weekend Edition. Now I am joined by my man Loki Rothman. Is it Rothman?
Rothman, yeah.
Rothman.
Yeah.
From Cape Town,
Belleville.
I almost said Bellevue. Belleville. Yeah, man. So awesome. Welcome to Weekend Edition. Sorry about that tough question earlier. You copped out. You did cop out. You basically put
I'll
the blame
it.
On Vusi, but it's cool. You are a musician, but. The first time people saw you was on SA's Got Talent, right?
Yeah. It was 2009, yeah.
Fresh out of high school, and you went straight for a talent show, and you made it to the top six, right?
Yeah. That was kind of a gateway into actually, well, kind of, it was a catapult for my career to actually not
right.
go and, obviously, I was going to go and study something. I didn't even know. I knew, obviously, I wanted to do music.
Yes.
But obviously, you know, parents, like, you have
yeah,
to go,
you have to... Were your parents skeptical about your music career?
No, not at all. But I definitely probably would have gone and studied, like, sound engineering or something like that. And that was, like, my first year out of school, I started playing show, like, doing corporate gigs, and I kind of started earning money off that, and I started a music school. And then they were like, okay, that's
When That's you were
great.
Doing these corporate
Just
gigs,
moving who, forward.
Whose music were you performing? Were you performing?
Oh, I was doing like a guitar. It's like a guitar show,
right?
Guitar circus show kind of thing, yeah.
And were you singing other people's songs?
Yeah.
Okay.
Back then, yeah.
And then, so which was your first big break? Because I know that you've toured with some big name musicians in the past.
Yeah.
Was it the SA's Got Talent thing, or was it when you kind of got a break with Jack Parow and those guys?
Yeah, it's kind of a bit of both. That's such a hard question. I don't know.
I've just been really lucky. Yeah.
I would say Issa's Got Talent definitely did wonders for my career in terms of to you know where I am now, and also the whole Jack Parow thing. And I was telling the story yesterday to someone and I actually went and wrote a Facebook message to a guy called Johnny Derrida.
Mm.
He plays in a famous South African rock band, and they've got a studio doing music for ads and stuff. And all that, and he phoned me up one day, I think it was 5 years after that. And he phoned me up.
He calls you 5 years after you send him a Facebook message?
Yeah, no, but I went through, sorry, I went through to their studio to go and job shadow when I was,
oh, right,
when
right,
I was
right.
17. Sorry, I skipped that part now.
5 years later, he calls you?
5 years later, he calls me, and he's like, this guy needs a guitarist for a track. I can't do it. Can you go through and record the parts? I'm like, yeah, sure. And I get there, and it's DJ Hightech from Die Antwoord.
Yeah,
and that's when I worked with them in studio, and I wrote I think three or two tracks with them. And also after that, his producer, or their producer, DJ High Tech, did Jack Parrow's studio, next studio album, the second one, XCO. And then I met Parrow in studio, and then it all came from one Facebook message I sent.
Get out of here, man. That's
when I
crazy.
Was 17 years old, yeah. It's
so it's true, you have to put it out there. Did you have you ever been on tour with Dion Ford or
No, I haven't been on tour, okay. only in studio, yeah.
Yeah. That's so incredible.
And he produced I co-produced my solo album with him, yeah.
Right. Which is called
The Way Back.
The Way Back, right. Yeah. It's The Way Back. You're going to perform Wheel Don't Turn from that in just a short moment. But you've released another album, which was a DVD, but it was like a visual DVD and instrumental music.
Yeah.
I haven't seen it. So what is that? Was it like lessons on how to play the guitar?
No. A lot of people thought that. But the thing is, I'm a guitarist, and then I'm a singer-songwriter. And always it shows. It's so hard when I'm playing, doing like all these guitar tricks and stuff, and people are like, yo, but we also want to, did you have something to sell that's, has the CD got that on? And then it's like, singer-songwriter, so I think there's like three guitar solos on that album.
Yeah.
And then that's when I thought, okay, I'm going to record a guitar, instrumental guitar album. I think there's a couple of cover songs on there as well. And so I went into the studio and I was like, why don't I just make a DVD? Because it's a visual thing, right?
Right.
A lot of people don't want to listen in their car to just instrumental music, guitar music. So I thought it's more a thing of seeing like...
It's for the aficionado, the person who's like, yeah, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Right.
And the DVD was called Sinductly. It was a thing that I was born with. I was born with web fingers on both sides.
That is
so
crazy, right?
It was one skin up until here.
Yeah.
And as you can see there, it was web. I think it was like 23 operations from, for 2 years when I was born. I was 2.5 or something, and then.
Is it true that you only found out you had this condition when your parents told you at a later stage?
Yeah. Well. I've always knew about it, but they never kind of like. Yeah, how can I say this? Yeah, they
never got into detail.
Yeah. I actually heard the story because I just thought, okay, my fingers were stuck together, and I had like an operation, and that was that.
Yeah.
And then, so someone came. I think it was like it was on some other show, and they told me that they asked me they want to interview my parents and hear the full story. So I was sitting behind the camera, going like, Jesus, that what happened?
right.
Like, 20 years, I mean, that was, I think it was like 20 years, or that was after Issa's Got Talent.
I think it was an
interview after Issa's Got Talent. And it was a pretty cool story. My mom obviously went through a rough 3 years with me. Because there was other complications, and the story goes on, but.
And that's crazy that now you're a guitar player, and not just a guitar player, but a super accomplished guitar player. You mastered several genres, and, you know what I mean? You're not supposed to play guitar, right?
Yeah, I think that's the weird thing, but I never thought of it like that. There was a 2 years back, someone asked me to do like a thing at a school, and then I realized, oh, but that's actually a cool kind of inspiring story to tell to tell kids how things work out like that.
Yeah.
Of all the careers I could have chosen,
yeah,
I use my hands every day.
That is incredible.
Yeah.
Well, look, I think people need to see those who haven't seen you perform what your performance is all about. So you're going to perform from The Way Back, which is your current album, right?
Yeah.
Song's called Wheel Don't Turn.
Wheel Don't Turn.
For which you, did you win a Summer for it?
No, I got nominated. It was for Best Pop Album.
All right, there you go. Yeah. All right, well, there you have it, man.
Awesome, thank you.
Loki Rothman. Take your stage. Here he is to perform for all of us here on Weekend Edition.
Mm-hmm. When karma doesn't work the way that it should, nice guys finish last. That's just the way that it works. When you get turned down by someone you loved and they're gone, when you find out they never loved you at all, I don't know where you go now. Not for me. I just step back. I just let it slide. You never showed up. It was no surprise. When you're happy, some other proof I loved worked for me, but not for you. I don't know where you go now. It's a lonely road, far from home. So much to do and so much to say, and there were days that I wished it all away, but everything feels the same these days. I was just another game you play. Whenever you had time, I don't know where you go now. It's a lonely road.
So as I told you, keep the conversation going on Facebook. It is Weekend Edition. Twitter and Instagram, The Weekend on 3. And let us know what you think of what Lo just did for us. See you after the break. It's a weekend,
yeah. It's a weekend, yeah. Welcome back to Weekend Edition. We've got another guest here. You've seen him earlier on. His name is Sia Beyile. Yes. Thank you for coming onto the show,
Thank
man.
Thank you for having me.
We've all worked together before.
Yes.
Yeah, Sia is a fashion blogger, stylist, influencer, the whole nine. And
the
we work together.
Influential on Forbes. That's also huge.
Oh, all right, we'll get into
yes,
that.
Yes, it's very big.
But we worked together at the South African Music Awards, right?
Yes.
It's nice to have you here, man.
Thank you
for coming.
When you guys called, I was like, I have to do this.
Yeah?
I felt obliged that I have to be here.
Well, thank you for coming. You've just come back from New York doing big things. What was happening in New York?
Yes, I got invited there for a conference for Meeting of the Minds, Africa's Next Entrepreneurial Generation.
Excuse
and
us.
And I was there talking about...
Were you there? You weren't there? No, okay.
And I was talking about...
Oh, you were the last generation. We were the last generation.
I'm going to bite your nose. I swear to God, I'm going to bite your nose.
All right.
Yeah,
don't do that.
I was basically talking about where I'm going to take Africa with my business over the next 20 years. And while I was there, made some power moves and... Yeah, people will just have to see those unfold.
Sure.
Get out of here. So you're 22 years old.
I'm 22 years old, yes.
And he made it to the Forbes under, not under 40, the under 30 list. What is it? The Forbes, I don't even want to say it. That's how much I hate this. The Forbes 30 under 30 tomorrow's billionaires list. Mm.
Yes.
So you were put in that list.
Yes, as one of only 5 South Africans.
So when they put you in a list like that, does it put a lot of pressure on you, or do you get taken into a room where they're like, no, we got you. This is what's gonna happen. By 2080, you'll be a billionaire. Like, how does it work?
Well, they call you up. They come to your offices. They vet your business, your financials, and they get like a private firm to have a look and project how successful your business can become. They look at your position in the market, your influence in the market. So because of the way I've transformed the way people see fashion in terms of its business and its potential in Africa, that's where they saw my influence, yeah.
What is the difference between your model and other people? By the way, you are the founder of ThreadedMan.com.
Yeah.
What's the difference in your approach to fashion and your business model to others?
So I'm the founder of the Threaded Man Group, and the Threaded Man Group is a company that specializes within the fashion and lifestyle market. And our biggest thing is that for a very long time, I felt that in the African fashion and lifestyle landscape, majority of us are nice and black. We have melanin. But when you look at the advertising of the fashion, when you look at our celebrities, no one really cared about the business of fashion. Mm. So I was like, let me create a platform, you know, called The Threaded Man as a website. And this website will become a pillar for black people when it comes to fashion and lifestyle. Because when you look at marketing, when you look at all these fancy international magazines, you know, they don't put us on the covers. We are lucky to be on the covers. But also when you see the adverts, there's no black people. But then we're out here, you know. But they want our money, but they don't want to involve us. So I was like, you know what, I want to build a platform for black people that specializes in fashion and lifestyle. And then sort of it grew into Africa's largest fashion and lifestyle portal. We got an award for that this year. And then from there, naturally, because of the influence of the website, I started being called by brands to now consult. So one of my clients are like Adidas. I also consult out for the Titan Group, which has Jaguar and also the Titan watches, and then also fashion director for the summer. So the brand just grew into having different divisions that are growing quite well. Yeah.
You're only 22.
I'm 22.
South Africa's getting younger and younger by the day, I swear.
Right. Okay, so you're from Cape Town, well, PE, and then you grew up in Cape Town?
No, so my family, yes, Dutywa, Eastern Cape. I grew up with a family that didn't have a lot, but they always loved their culture. I mean, my family was always really about the culture. I think that's where my passion for fashion came about, was that because Ndungumxhosa, a lot of the ceremonies, there's a lot of dressing, there's a lot of ways of you can't just wear anything, you know? And being the first grandson of both families, I was also dressed in a certain way. So from there, I was like, you know, as black people, fashion for us is not just about being trendy and cool, but it's also about telling our stories, it's also about telling our heritage. And that's what most brands miss when they market to us, that, yeah, that looks cool, but what story is it telling? And I felt that through my website, I wanted to say, yes, we can be stylish and trendy and look international, but still showcasing our culture as luxury. Mm. Our culture all our cultures are incredible across Africa, and that's what I wanted to showcase. Mm. Yeah.
Wow. Tell us about your experience doing the Summer Awards as a fashion director. Was that your first time doing a task like that live telecast? That a huge project?
It was the first time doing a show of that gravitas. Mm. I think at first, when I got appointed as a fashion director for the Summers, I thought it was a joke. You know, initially when I walked into the SABC offices with the CEOs and everybody saying, listen, want to do the fashion, I thought they were literally thinking, nah, let's just put this kid and see what he can do. And, you know, within the industry, there's a lot of politics. There's stylists who've been around forever who were never given that opportunity. Yeah. So there was a lot of pressure, a lot of eyes, people saying, why would they give it to a 22-year-old? They're losing their minds. But, you know, I was like, there's a reason why God put me in that position, you know, and I felt that I've got an incredible team. And, yeah, we just never looked back after signing that contract.
What's been the feedback from your competitors, your older competitors? Because fashion blogging, like, it seems like so many people are into this thing.
Yeah.
And I don't even know what it means anymore because so many people do it.
Yeah.
What's been the response to your rise?
Can I just put it out there? I think I started off as a blogger, but I'm no longer a blogger.
Okay.
I'm a fashion entrepreneur. Let's put it
all
that
right,
way.
All right. You're bloggers just owning the fashion blogging
thing. Bloggers don't get on the Forbes list.
Yeah, I mean, right.
But I think if you I think if you look at the industry and the market, I think blogging anymore is not a simple thing of sharing your experience online. Blogging is now a global business, a multi-million dollar global yeah. business. And what bloggers are missing here is that, I mean, I went to New York recently where I interacted with other bloggers who have teams of up to 30 people. I mean, if you look at Chiara Ferragni, the highest paid blogger in the world, she makes $8 million a year. She's about to make 20 this year.
Yeah.
So blogging internationally is actually a real legitimate is a legitimate business, but here we're still thinking blogging is about, you know, going into the club and looking pretty or wearing something cool, but blogging is about curating a lifestyle that people are after. And I think in South Africa, we're still missing it because socialites are also not bloggers. Yeah. You know, a celebrity now is like, ah, blogger, let me put blog on my title. So I think it, in some ways people diminish it, but actually—
Speak on it, man. It's actually a real career
that takes time, you know?
Yeah. Look at the camera, man.
I didn't just wake up and be like, oh, I'm gonna be a blogger. I sat and I was like, cool, who am I talking to? How am I communicating them? You know, what do I want people to feel when they look at the website? What is the user experience? How can brands market on the website? What can they do?
And your focus is men's clothing.
Men's and women's now.
Oh, men's and
women's. It's grown into women's. Yeah.
You don't want to talk about what you're doing in New York. You want to keep it mum. I mean.
Yeah, man. You know, I've learned that in this industry, you just gotta do the work and.
Seems like a lot of jewelry is moving to New York, eh? Can you?
They're leaving, man. They're going. That's what I said.
They're going one by one.
But I'd like to know when you look at the fashion in South Africa now, because we get a lot of South Africans that are trying to get international stylists to dress them. How would you rate us on a worldly scale?
I think there's still we have still a lot to learn. I think in South Africa we still don't understand there's a difference between being a style icon and being stylish. A big difference, you know? In a sense that someone who's a style icon is someone who's breaking new boundaries, trying new things. You know what I'm saying? Always, you know, you look, Lady Gaga's a style icon. Beyonce dresses well, but she's not a style icon.
No.
Rihanna's a style icon.
Yes.
Beyonce dresses well. Beyonce dresses well. Being a style icon is about trying new things and it's about breaking boundaries. It's about shocking people.
You love the Kardashians, so.
I think Kim is just a cultural influencer. You know, in a sense that...
She's like the Zara of...
Fashion, she is. And the thing about the Kardashians is that I study their business model because it's so, so, so brilliant in a sense that, you know, they've able to use their platforms to build this incredible lifestyle that people are after. If you put something on Kim Kardashian, it sells out completely. I mean, you look at the G-Wagon. I mean, you look at Balmain, the brand. You look at all the fashion brands they've worn, how commercial they've become. I mean, everyone says that Kanye made Kim cool, but also look at where Kanye is with Kim, you know, in terms of his cultural relevance and the selling out of his sneakers and how, look at how they market product. If, you know, the Yeezy are gonna drop, all of a sudden all the Kardashians are wearing it and posting it online. Look at Kendall Jenner's modeling career. Look at Kylie being the most influential millennial in the world right now, where her makeup company is now is worth $10 million. Like, and she's only how old, like 19 years old. So their business model is actually quite incredible to watch and see. And now Kim's on the cover of Forbes and everyone's like, well, she has no talent. Well, trust me, that takes a lot of talent to do that.
But the
issue is in South Africa, I feel that designers act like stylists. And there is a difference, right?
I think in South Africa, we have a huge problem in a sense that everyone wants to be a celebrity. You know, in a sense that I love my job. You know, besides running the Thread of Man, within my job, I'm also a stylist. I'm not afraid, you saw at the Summers, I was not afraid to come while you were shooting and get down on my knees and tie your shoelaces or fix, you know, your shoes or fix whatever. That's my job and I take pride in my job. But you get stylists who don't want to be seen doing that thing because they're too cool. So instead, they want to pose next to Kanye. But how am I posing to Kanye when I'm working for Kanye? You know what I'm saying? So there's that problem as well. And also just generally the designers as well just want quick, everyone just wants this quick gratitude. You know, where I believe, you know, the fashion and design process is a process. You know, you look at Rihanna, her stylist is Mel Ottenberg, who is about building the Rihanna brand. Actually my job
is being... never knew who that person was till recently.
So I see my job as being a brand builder. And to be a brand builder, you've got to be behind the brand in order to grow it, in order to push it. Yeah. But here, everyone just wants to have a lot of followers on Instagram. Everyone wants to be seen at the right parties and be socialites and not actually do the actual job. Everyone wants the influencer, the title of being an influencer. No one actually pays attention to the art. I mean, I went to fashion school for this. It's not something that I just decided by, yo, I'm going to be cool. It's actually everything that I do from the color palettes that I choose on my Instagram, to the color palettes that I choose on Khanyi, to how I envisioned the summers, the opening number, how I envisioned her dress. That takes, it's an actual art. You don't just sit there and draw it off
with
your
hand. You put some easy in a dress, didn't you?
I put him in a kilt.
Yeah, in a kilt.
No, you
in
put him
kilt.
In a dress. You put him in a dress. how did you deal with? Because I know you encountered a bit of depression in your upbringing and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Just talk a bit about that, and also your father was not in your life.
Yeah, I think most of the time everyone goes on about how I'm sort of 22 and I'm doing all these amazing things, but most people don't know is that I don't come from a rich family. You know, I don't come from family that gave me all these opportunities, but I came from a family of hard workers who were like, we're gonna give you this education, you're gonna see how you push that. My parents divorced when I was 13, the day before, like literally the day before I went to high school, like on my, the night before grade 8, I remember my mom throwing my dad's clothes out the house.
Amen.
And for me, that was a huge step because, I mean, I went to Wamba Boys High School. And I was on scholarship there. And for me, it was a huge thing not having my father there and my mom having to balance two jobs to make sure that she keeps three boys fed.
Yeah.
And from that moment, and she said to me, listen, dude, like, I can't give you anything more. If you want a new phone, if you want the clothes, if you want to live a great lifestyle, you got to have to work hard for it.
And I think
that moment was when I decided that I'm going to be an entrepreneur. That's when I decided, look, I'm actually going to put in the hours. So people are only seeing the success now, but I've been pushing and working ever since.
Yeah.
In high school, I did everything. You know, I did music. In high school, I felt like I wasn't talented. I wasn't known for academics. I wasn't known for sport. But I was like, you know what? I'm going to work damn hard at everything that I do.
Yeah.
So I worked hard at the music. I worked hard at everything. And those things eventually, God started saying, cool, with these skills, these will prepare you to be an entrepreneur. And in high school, I mean, being also in Cape Town and at a school like that as well, you face racial stuff, you know, in terms of like in school, my mom couldn't afford to buy me Woolworths food. So I would arrive there with some musho, isonga samanze, and the kids would take out their Woolworths lunch.
Yeah.
And the kids were like, what is that? It smells disgusting.
Wow.
And I'd be like, this is my culture. I love it. So from that young age, because I didn't have money, I took my culture as my pillar and I was so proud to wear my culture proudly.
What caused the depression?
A depression was probably because the depression came because of the fact that, especially in the last 2 years, where I realized, like, oh, snap, I didn't have a childhood, you know, because
you're so
of
busy trying to be grown up, yeah.
And because of what happened between my parents, I don't know what a good family looks like as well. And I struggled with my own personal relationship with my friends, with girlfriends, where I can't give them that emotional thing that they want. They want that guy who's going to be romantic and giving, where, oh, what I've always known is survival. What I've always known is working. So now to adapt into that step of being like,
but
okay.
But haven't you found since then that there's really no such thing as this nuclear family? Like, I haven't
there's
seen
no such
one.
Thing.
I've never seen one.
I think
one.
It's about it's you. I think what I've realized is that, you know, being blood doesn't mean we're family.
Mm.
I feel like in my life I've been able to choose my family to be like, these are the people that make me happy, this is my home. No matter where I am in the world, these are the people that I can talk to. And I've also learned to have the right friends around me. You know, I know what triggers me to get into that space.
Yeah.
You know, with my work, it keeps me happy.
Gotcha.
So that's my home as well. So being 22 and doing what I do, and also now especially getting media attention and fame, if you want to call it that, it is tough.
Yeah.
You know, it is tough, but you learn every single day, and I would never have my life any other way. And what I love is that my struggles, I'm able to be vocal about them and use them for other young people who might be facing those things or other young people who dream of having a career in the industry that I'm in.
All right, we're getting a little dark. I want to keep it light now. We've got a really cool idea. We're going to do something we've never done on this show. Vusi, why don't you come on down? He comes bearing gifts and goodies.
Yeah, so we're going to have some fun now.
Yeah, we're going to have some fun.
Bit of fun.
I'll explain to you what all of these are. after the break, the weekend edition continues just after this. It's a weekend, yeah. It's a weekend, yeah. Welcome back to the weekend edition. Once again, keep that social media pumping. We are on Facebook, it's weekend edition, on Instagram and Twitter. We are The Weeknd on 3. All right.
Hashtag Weeknd Edition.
So now we've got Sia here, who is a stylist, fashion entrepreneur.
Yes.
Right? Not a fashion blogger.
He doesn't blog.
Used to be. Yeah. Founder of Threaded Man. And we figured we'd do something fashion related. We're going to have a fashion review.
Let's do it.
Yeah, is that cool?
Yes.
And people can get a sense of how you look at fashion, right?
Yes, definitely.
Khanyi, you're a fashionista, so I'm looking forward to hearing your take on our local celebrities and their different looks, right?
Well, yes.
All right, so first
up, I'll bring the shade and the spice.
First up, we've got very popular fashionista, Maps Maponyan. We've got a picture of him here. It looks like he was at some fashion film festival. I don't know what type of outfit he's wearing. I don't know if the jacket is snakeskin or what, but what do you make of his outfit? do you think it's a Kanye yeah or a no Joe? And, why do you guys not like the picture?
For me, that's two different weeks, two different events. The pants and the shoes belong to another event, and the shirt and that belong. So he's having a, I don't know, a virtual experience. What is this, hologram?
Yeah, like, I think this look is a bit too much.
It is.
The bottom and the shoes, I don't know, it just doesn't work.
It's Wednesday.
The jacket could work and the white shirt, but it needs a different bottom entirely.
Friday.
But I just think the blazer actually is just too, like, it's just too much. I don't know how I can make that look work in general. Like, I don't know how to make that blazer work.
Because it's giving me tie-dye vibes.
Yeah, tie-dye, so snake skin. But I mean, at the same time, it's Mavs. Things always fit him well, but I just think visually, the pattern on the blazer, I don't know if those are jeans or chinos, and then the shoes just look, no, I don't think this is a very sharp look at all.
For he usually looks really sharp, but on this day, I would also have to ask, where was Nomzam?
Yeah.
Probably she was at some film festival somewhere, I don't know.
Yeah. All right, our next picture, it's also an event. It looks like a racehorse. I think this was Durban, was it not?
No, Sansui.
Sansui, okay. This is Pearl Tusi. She is, I don't know, what do you guys think of that outfit?
I'm just saying, thank God she's in the States now where the real players are. She will be playing big because that to me, I don't know, it gives me SAPC choir vibes at the top. And then here she's giving me Rihanna, like R&B vibes on
sunglasses.
That crop top. It's too much. Like, she is in all eras, Kora music, everything. You know, Summer Awards, everything, all the genres of music are there. Yeah. The shade, no, Pearl, no.
I think we all know that Pearl's a beautiful woman. She's beautiful even here. But I just think that it's the details that celebrities always miss. I think the silhouette looks great, but the pattern, the SABC choir vibes.
The choir, bro.
Like, it needs an uplift. And then, and also the top just gives me a very, like, I'm innocent, I don't do a lot of things. And then all of a sudden, boom, there's a party happening here. Then the skirt is, it looks like she's going to bury someone. But
she was from a party with the skirt and the top and the shades.
And then
one of her friends said, no, just take this top and cover up. Let's pass by quickly.
Yeah.
You know?
Like, I don't know, man.
It's a mess.
Even if she wore that to my funeral, I'll be very offended.
Oh, my gosh. Wow.
So
all right.
I don't know what she's bearing.
Okay, we're going to switch it up now. We're going to... what's his name again?
Katleho.
My boy, ne?
Yes.
Yeah. Cat is here. He looks like he's coming out of his apartment or something like that, or a hotel. But he's clearly styling there. What do you guys think of his look?
He gets Dora the Explorer, and I'll tell you why. Just the pose alone is paparazzi. He's ready. Whether it's coming out of his house, his job, whatever, he's ready for it. That's suave, man. Look at those jeans. Look at the polo neck. Look. Hi, guys. I can even smell what he smells like. He smells good.
There's two things I like about this picture. Number one is the fact that, like, he looked like it's, you know, the morning after, you scored your girl, you're feeling good, you're like, yes, she's mine now.
No.
He's got that look, and then Tovity actually looks great. So that really helps. I like that he kept it all black. The boots, you see the difference between Maps' boots and his boots, you can see those are like quality boots, so it's shaped.
Money.
And everything fits well.
Yes.
You know, I genuinely like this look, and then added the young Glasnyana, the sharpness of his haircut.
You can even hear the soundtrack playing in that. You can hear it.
This is why this guy won the You Spectacular. That's why
he's spectacular.
There you go.
All right.
Let's switch it up. Keep this fashion review moving. This is one of the most talked about outfits in recent times. This is Boiti, of course, wearing her Sama dress, South African Music Awards. She wore it this year. We were all there. I actually saw her after the event in the hotel after the dress trended. And I couldn't help but, like, try and look down at her crotch. She was coming out of the elevator, and I was like, I had to, because I don't know. But, like...
A full host of that show.
Exactly. So what do you guys think of the dress?
She reminds me of the Little Mermaid when she got her legs for a day. Remember, what was her name? Muriel or whatever, they gave her wish, and she got to walk for a day. So for me, it's like the seaweed still stuck on her, you know, and the ocean water. It gives me those vibes. And the chest ain't right. the chest ain't right for that because it doesn't support her properly. But for me, it reminds me of the Little Mermaid when she got her dream of walking out. That's why you probably saw the crotch, because yeah. The seaweed was now moving away.
And so you're kind of in the middle or on the fence?
It's a no-go from me. And this hurts me. I'm sitting so left. I have a crush on Boydie.
Me too.
And like being a stylist, I want to put Bae on, man. Mm. I want to put her on. Boydie's beautiful, great body. Like anything fits her well, but I just feel like this just didn't do her justice. First and foremost, it doesn't show her knees very flattering. It looks like she has ashy knees. Number two, there's a whole thing about, you know, the crotch area. And then I don't know where she's flying to.
The Little Mermaid.
I don't know, man. Like,
it
was just like, it just didn't work.
Don't some outfits just look better in real life than they play out on pictures?
This in real life was The Little Mermaid.
Also in real life, it was a lot to take.
All right. Okay, so we've got rapper Fifi Cooper here. I'd never seen her in a dress before. And I felt like this was the first time in her life she put on a dress and she was just like, okay, I'll try it. What did you guys think?
Look, for me, I'll give it Dora the Explorer.
Really?
Yes, I'll give it Dora. Reason because, you know, I know the designer, he's dressed me a couple of times and I understand what he was trying to do with her.
What was
the only brief that she missed? This is a beautiful creation. She missed the attitude. When you wear something, it has a personality that you put to it. If she had given us more of a, you push it out, you know, give us more hip, you would have seen what this dress was supposed to do.
But quite a slender smile. I feel like that's a baggy dress.
No, it isn't. They could have made it tighter, but that dress is dazzling, especially for the lights and everything that she wanted to do. She can't be innocent in that, in such a low back.
Yeah.
Wants a gully, it wants a lash that's here, but she missed it.
Yeah. I think I'll also give a Kanye, Dora the Explorer vibe. For various reasons, I mean, I think this is definitely a step in the right direction. Mm. I mean, to get Fifi Cooper like this, wow, what a miracle. Mm. So that is a huge achievement. Mm. But I think what didn't work well, I think the hair could have been more sharper, like a nice bob, the makeup, the lashes could have been there.
Is that not a wig?
I don't even know what she has on.
It must be sharp.
Like, so I think she needed a good weave, some good color on her face. She did some nice jewelry on the arms. Mm. The dress could have worked. I just think that she just put on the dress and that was like, oh, I'm going out.
I don't understand why you guys are bigging it up when you got so much criticism for the outfit. All right, well, that's it for our fashion review, guys. Once again, Sia, thank you for partaking. Khanyi, you too as well. Yeah?
Thank you.
It's a pleasure.
All right, so now our hotspot of the week is a retail center that makes eco-conscious sexy. It's called 27 Boxes, and that's exactly what it is. It's 27 repurposed shipping containers that bring an industrial flair to the suburb of Melville in Joburg.
Turning the concept of a shopping mall completely on its head, 27 Boxes in Melville owes its eye-catching look to being constructed entirely out of shipping containers. It's a first for Africa, modeled on similar projects in London, Paris, and Christchurch.
27 Boxes, it's quite funky, it's very new, there's lots of different things around, and it's the perfect place for everyone that has different things to be.
I've been here for about a year now, and it's really been challenging, but also exciting, really, because firstly, the concept of the whole place is just something unique, different, it's cool, it's very vibrant and colorful. So it's really something different to offer people out there, especially in terms of having a shopping experience. And then, of course, the fact that at least 99% of the stores here are locally produced, you know, so it's just sort of one foundational culture where one can come and know that they'll find all sorts of different creative aspects that are local, you know, so it is exciting to be a part of this, and hopefully it'll be more years, you know, while the person's actually still here, and just grow with that.
We joined 27 Boxes soon after they opened, and it's a lovely modern, different, fun vibe to be here. We're very, very happy here, and just lovely customers, and Melville is really supportive, and we fit really well in Melville. We're very happy here.
It's a beautiful concept. The 27 Boxes alone, the architecture alone is beautiful, it's creative. They've been trying to promote new business startups, and the ideas are beautiful.
The name of the project is derived from the size of the containers, each measuring 27 square meters, and recycling them this way makes space cost effective for shop owners.
Yumi Wee is a unique bespoke label by three sisters and their mother. Everything's made by them, designed by them, and Yumi Wee was the perfect spot right here at 27 Boxes for us.
Clothing brands like these won't easily be found at malls packed with franchise stores. Here, the focus is on giving artists and entrepreneurs an opportunity to build their business.
Okay, my brand is called Munyu, Munyu Fashion Studio. We've basically been operating for just over 4 years now. At the moment, it's just currently a ready-to-wear brand. So we basically just focus on your everyday fashionable woman. Our inspiration for the colors and textures and the fabrics that we use, well, firstly, are obviously always about quality. And more than anything, the colors that we choose obviously always sort of work with what's currently trending as well. So we tend to incorporate that with what we obviously find to be appropriate in terms of what we're trying to put out there. Choosing the right fabrics, choosing something that's quite unique can be a bit challenging, but obviously is also quite a priority for us. And we're always trying to go for something. I personally like very free-flowing clothing, very comfortable. So the choices that I make are always based on finding fabric that's going to be quite smooth, quite soft on the body.
Because shopping is hungry work, this retail center has ensured that everyone, young and old, has a place to relax with the children's play area and great eateries like the Countess.
We're a steampunk restaurant, and the uniqueness is that exactly who we are. Everything is individual, a lot of fun, a lot of metal, fits in really well with our boxes. And we wanted to make a really cool atmosphere. It was very unique and special, like our food.
Just like the menu featuring decadent truffle mac and cheese and peanut butter and chocolate cheesecake, everything has been designed from scratch, including the decor and artwork.
Friend took those photographs to kind of fit in with the space we had. We went around scrapyards and looked for bits that would fit into certain areas, like our light fittings, and people specifically designed certain pieces of artwork to go in the certain areas to give us the best idea, and just to create this really lovely vibe to make it really unique and different and make people feel great when they came to eat by us.
You can also find furniture, art, and other artisan goods inside the colorful boxes, as well as pop-up shops for those searching for something truly unique and proudly South African.
We're called The Strong One, Krachtdrach, and we've been here since last year, August, and we've been doing pretty well. It's creative stuff. It's awesome things. I mean, look at the Happy Chappy alone, the Zambucks of today, and I mean, alone, if you look at the store alone, you see that there's a lot of creativity and artwork being put into the store.
Clever, colourful and kind to the planet, 27 Boxes proves that you can support small local businesses in a fun and environmentally friendly way that makes for the ideal weekend spot.
All right, so 27 Boxes in Melville. Mm. I used to actually spend a lot of time in Melville. You've been there.
Yes.
And you enjoy it.
It's arty, it's different, great restaurants, great designer outlets. It's yeah. A nice place.
All right, giving you options all the time. This is the weekend edition. Now, I think it's time for... You've made this for me before.
I haven't made this for you before.
Oh, wow.
Girl, well, you did.
I swear I didn't. We were working with cheer butters, we scooped the bread out and it was just egg and bacon.
Okay, what did you call that?
A cheer butter breakfast cup.
It wasn't.
See?
Okay, all right. All right, so this is called. This is a breakfast pizza.
This is a breakfast pizza bowl.
Okay.
So, really easy to prepare. I say, you know, like most of us do love pizza. Why wouldn't we want to have it for breakfast?
That's what I'm thinking.
So, simple, because you can actually just buy ready made pizza dough in the store. You don't have to make it
yourself.
So,
this is actual pizza dough.
This is actual pizza dough, but if you've got kids at home and you want them to get involved, I mean, pizza dough is...
It's great fun to make,
It's great fun to make. It's flour, semolina, yeast and water, that's it, you know? So really easy, but this makes it even easier. So maybe you've only decided to do this in the morning, shoot out, get some dough. You're going to take a skillet, which is a heavy bottom-based pan.
Okay.
And you're going to push the dough out into this. You always want to come higher than the edges because pizza dough, we know how it kind of shrinks back on itself. Just keep on pulling until it's come over the edge of the pan, and then this is going to bake for about 10 minutes. It's just going to cook it.
You got to do that,
Yeah, so then once this comes out is when we want to start adding our ingredients. For me, very important part of a pizza is, of course, the tomato sauce, which I always make my own one. I think it's just...
Yeah?
Yeah, we're going.
Fire's going.
So, tinned chopped tomatoes, that goes into your pan.
Okay.
We're going to add some fresh herbs. Oh, thank you. Some thyme. I think it's always good with tomatoes. So we just want to pull off some of these thyme leaves. Probably looking for about just a half, 2 teaspoons kind of thyme. That's going to go in and cook through. And then I think I've said it before with the tomatoes, acidity.
I was going to ask you about the sugar. Yeah,
so
I always
add sugar. So we've
got to
add some sugar. and that's just 2 teaspoons of brown sugar, and that's gonna cook and reduce. All of those beautiful flavors are really, really gonna soak into those tomatoes.
It smells nice, yeah.
So that'll smell good, that'll taste good. This has now been cooking for a little while. We wanna carefully take it out of here because we wanna keep our bowl shape.
Okay.
And then we're going to use this and simply flip it over. It's gonna come almost like our pizza base oven. The reason...
Right. It's getting a little sticky, yeah?
There we go. The reason we wanna do this is because we want these bits to obviously crisp up, so that's why we're gonna now invert onto the pan. And don't worry, if you've got a couple of edges, we'll fix that at the end. And then I've already made some tomato sauce that's already done. And then, like we would with a pizza, we're gonna get this...
Spread it in there.
Spread this into the base. And then where you really have fun is decide what you wanna put in your pizza. For me, breakfast, again, instead of just using normal bacon, prosciutto, because I just love that smokiness of cured meat. So we're going for our nice thick tomato base. We're going to first before my prosciutto some asparagus, because I think asparagus and eggs, and of course there are eggs involved. I'll do that now. So we've taken the asparagus stalks, we've taken a peeler and made them into these beautiful thin
ribbons. Yeah.
So this is gonna go in next. So these are all the colors that are gonna make this really pretty at the end. So that goes in. Then we're going to, might as well use all of it. We need our mozzarella cheese. And this is about 1.5 cups. So, because it's a bowl, we actually want to fill this quite a bit.
Right, so should I be stirring this?
That can just, we want it to cook like that, because that's all of that runny liquid's going to cook away. So cheese, and then prosciutto, which is going to crisp up, because this is going to go back in the oven for about 8 minutes before the eggs. We don't want eggs to
overcook. You put the eggs in last.
So I put the eggs in last. Otherwise, they become too hard, too rubbery.
Yeah, exactly.
This looks like a
great hangover dish as well. You know what I mean? Yeah?
What do you mean? No.
You know, like after a wild night and you're hungry, rather than go to the local.
The boys have slept over.
Yeah, exactly.
Buy your pizza dough, you know, if you think you're gonna be out the night before, buy your pizza dough the evening before and just keep it in the fridge. Take it out half an hour before you start working with
it. Go busy.
This is looking good. This I'm not gonna panic about too much. I'm just gonna see if I can work it together with my fingers. We've got enough. If not, you would take some oil, wet your fingers with, and we'll just actually literally, because we've got enough thickness, just work that dough together. We've got enough play. And then very carefully, we wanna take this and pop it into
just
the
like
oven.
That. Upside down.
Upside down. This is gonna get beautiful.
Why does that look scary?
It's not, why does it look scary?
I don't know, looks like something
upside
might happen.
Upside down, something's not gonna happen. So this is gonna go in like that. Your oven is nice and hot at 200 degrees. And I'm gonna let that cook for 8 minutes before the eggs go in.
Why not keep it in the pan the way it was and do that? That's kind of like, my instinct is to...
If you keep that in the pan, so I don't know if you saw, you know where I could move the edges of that dough around. If we keep that in the pan, for me, I always wanna be able to, you know, crack off bits of your pizza base. It's gotta be crunchy. And if you keep it in the pan, you're not gonna get the crust.
It's about the crust.
And the crunch.
Okay, got you.
Why.
All right, I'm with you.
So
I'm
that's
with
the
you.
First part of the
That's
pizza.
A good reason. Okay, perfect. All right, so what do we do now?
So we're gonna wait for that to cook, and then we're going to have to do our egg cracking.
All right, cool. Well, I guess
While you wait for that, I will remind you to keep the conversation going, please, on Facebook, The Weekend Edition, and on Twitter and Instagram, The Weekend on 3. Hashtag us, send us videos, The Weekend Edition, and tell us what you think, and will you make this for yourself? See you after the break. It's a weekend. Welcome back to the Weekend Edition, part 2 of Chilling Out with Vusi Nova. You know I have to get deep on you though.
Yes.
I've heard your album and it, to me, it's like a novel. You're telling a story.
Yeah.
And I feel like it's a remedy for broken hearts. Who hurt you?
My ex. Actually, I ended it a month ago. And yeah, you're right, the song is about my relationship.
The whole album, not just the song.
Well, I mean, there's the one song I did for my parents.
Yes.
And then there's another song that Berita, you know Berita?
Yes.
She had told me a story about the day that she was born, so I sang about that.
Yeah.
But the rest of the songs are basically about my 3.5-year-old relationship that, as I'm saying, ended last month.
You and Adele,
I don't like...
You and Adele.
Look, I never like talking about my personal life, you know? But I guess for me to actually get into studio and record and actually sing about all of this, I guess for me it was therapeutic. You know, and I feel like I hope I can help other people out there who are going through the same thing. Because obviously, it's not just Mnandedwa. There are other people that go through Induzinjalo. You know, so hopefully, even if I'll be happy.
So you're like Toni Braxton, because Toni Braxton once said, she never sings about love, but she understands songs about heartbreaks.
That's true.
Why do you connect with it so much?
You see, for me, this is, as you said, this is, all the songs in there are my personal experience, you know? And as I said before, for me to actually just get into studio and sing about it helped me a lot, because it was tough, you know? Yes, people, we all go through it at some point, you know, heartbreak. But this was reality, like this is what happened for the past, 3 years of my life. And it's not easy to break up with someone after that long, you know? But it's just something that I had to do at the end of the day.
So someone's looking at you right now and thinking, that guy hurt me.
Looking at me?
Yeah, because you ended it.
I had to. As a person, you can only take so much, you know? And then after that, you just need to move on.
But how do you handle it? Because, you know, people don't understand. They always say to us, oh, you know, celebrities and artists can't keep relationships. They
That's
are the
not
worst.
True.
They
that
hop
is
from.
Not true.
No, they think that because one moment it's stories about you've broken up with this person.
Yeah.
How do you then deal with the whole love thing? How do you know it's real love? How do you know that it's worth fighting for with our busy schedules? I mean, it's not easy.
For me, I guess the first thing, you know, when you come across someone and you can actually tell that this person doesn't care about Vusi Nova, for example, the brand, you know? So I think that's the first thing, and that's very important to me. For example.
But have you gotten that before?
Hey, it's happened.
Where they call you by your name
it's not
and,
fun,
and the whole name.
Enova.
Oh my gosh, then you know.
No, that's not fun at all.
Yeah.
But I love Otando, as I said before, Nkosi Otando. Dinalo luninzi, man.
Yeah, you do.
I've got so much love to give. Ka abanye bantu mhlawumbe kukhula, you know? Mhlawumbe umuntu still wants to play around. Ready for a relationship, you know, obviously...
It's their own personal challenges
exactly,
themselves.
You know, and that's why I had to take myself out of that situation.
Now, knowing you, I've got a bone to pick. I've known you for a very long time. We see, like, we were kids and we've grown up literally together.
Yeah.
In the business, personally, and etc. You never speak about your personal life.
Yeah.
In the media. You don't like it.
I don't.
You choose
like,
not
I feel,
to.
I feel like... I give so much already. For example, the album, I'm speaking about it, I'm talking about it. I want that one thing to hold on to and say, this is mine. And that's why I never like talking about it, because that's the one thing I feel still belongs to me.
Yeah, but you spoke about your mom and her true cause. And I know that it's one thing that we never talk about in public, but you then came up with it and said, no, guys, it wasn't cancer, it was actually this.
Yeah.
What led to that?
You know, I think, again...
It was really out of character for you, though.
Yeah.
I must say.
Look, I mean, for me, again, it was just part of growing up and understanding that this is what's happening, and maybe lendo inganceda omnye umuntu out there. Do you get what I'm saying? And I think... Even myself, not myself, because it was eating me inside. I mean, I used to tell people that my mother had cancer.
I remember.
But in actual fact, she was HIV positive.
Yeah.
I'm okay with it now. You know, I'm okay with it. Mm. Going through the same thing.
Yeah.
you know. Mm.
So, I mean, now that you've come to this point of your life,
yeah.
Marriage, kids, are you about that life?
No. Kids, no. A kid, by the way. Not about what that means. I want one
a kid.
It has to be a boy. Has to
what
be.
If it's a girl?
Then I'll have to make another one.
So you, but what if it's another girl, so you just...
Oh, my goodness. Because
why? Girls are pretty. Girls are strong.
If I can get one boy, I'll be good. But in terms of marriage, no. I love my space. I love having someone there. But you know. Now, if you're married to someone, you can't do that. Because
become one.
You know, so right now in my life, I don't think indo and ifunayo right now. Who knows? Climbing mountains, I change along
the way. The worst experience you've ever gone through of being an artist?
Of being an artist?
Yes, where you're like, gosh, why did I get into this? Like that one thing. Have you ever had it?
Yeah, the papers, man.
Hey, the media.
The papers, the papers. And like you get into a space where you feel like, I can handle this, you know? But in actual fact, when you're chilling alone,
it eats you up
hard. So definitely the papers. And I still know, Wuti, there are still going to be other things out there. That people are going to say,
yeah.
Whether they're true or not.
Yeah.
And those are things that I have to deal with, unfortunately.
So if you had to speak to a boy from PE that's 14,
yeah,
what would you say to them? Because I know a lot of guys that sing that look at you and go, and I've personally heard them,
yeah,
that I'm going to be like Vusi Nova. I'm going to get there and I'm going to mess up the game.
I think the first thing is temptation. You know, avoid along the layer. Because temptation leads to things like drugs. You know, I mean, I started taking drugs when I was about 14, 15.
Sure.
You know? So temptation, definitely, and...
But where did you get the money to afford them? Because drugs are expensive at 14.
Well, I mean, so I moved to Joburg when I was 14. Mm. And my life totally changed when I got to Joburg. Because remember, in PE, I grew up with my grandmother. You know, there's like 13 of us in a one-bedroom house. And then all of a sudden, I got to Joburg, you know, staying in the burbs. You know, my mom, you know, she worked really hard.
Yes.
And she just spoiled me rotten. So, and I guess for me, it just started as chilling with the boys, you know. Let's do a bit of marijuana, you know? And then it just grew from that to Mandrax, from there to coke. It just went a bit crazy. And after my mom's passing, then that just made things worse.
Mm.
Because now all of a sudden, I didn't even have to ask for this money. Now this money was mine.
Hey, do you remember what I'm saying? Those days.
And yeah, and I guess for me, that's how I grieved. I spent a lot of money. Most of it I smoked. There was
and your
my
mom
way.
Left you a lot of money.
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
yeah. There was an experience and a half, you know. I've learned a lot from that. But I can proudly say I'm sitting here today, you know, I've been drug-free for years now, you know. And that's something I'm very proud of.
Yeah.
You know, and again, I guess umculo was that thing. Because I remember I woke up one day and I was thinking to myself, this is not how my life is supposed to be, you know?
Mm.
I love going out and seeing people and all of that, but now all of a sudden I was just stuck in the house because I was afraid that everyone could see that I was high.
Ish.
All of a sudden, but before it was okay. Like, it was okay to go out there. Now all of a sudden I can't do that, you know? And something just clicked, and I said, I have to stop. I mean, I even stopped cigarettes.
Sure. That's amazing.
You know? Yeah.
It's all in the mind. I think it's you know, it's all in the mind.
The thing is, you've got to have goals and dreams. You know, I feel like that's the other problem with our youth these days. I don't feel like abantu bayaphupha enough. You know? And I think kwakhona, I mean, if it's a pooper and upupe of driving, for example, some a golf, for example, for me that's a problem, you know. People are afraid to have to dream. People are afraid to have big dreams, you know. Now that's what helped me, and that's what I'm saying, that people just need to dream out there, man, and work hard towards Lotomileyo and whatever you want.
With hard work. So let's talk about this album now. Is it out? Where can people find it?
So it's out on iTunes.
Yes.
It's titled Na Ni Ni Na. I know it's on the charts already. So that's great.
Oh, wow.
It's coming out this week in all music stores.
Yes.
As I said, it's titled Na Ni Ni Na.
Produced by whom? Recorded where?
So I worked with two different producers. A guy by the name of Bongani Mahlaole. He's amazing. Bongani Mahlaole is the guy that also did Nati's album. He's amazing.
Wow.
And then Jakes as well. You know, Jakes, I mean, he's done so many hits in his career. So I'm proud of this album. It feels like my very first album.
That's what I also said, and Joe was like, but he's got another one. And I said, yes, he does. But for me, this is it. This is now you being yourself and not trying too hard.
This is me just putting myself out there. I feel like I'm not afraid to be vulnerable. I'm not afraid. I'm just putting it all out there.
Well, I want you to show us how you're not afraid by giving us another performance.
Definitely.
From Una Ni Ni Na.
I would love to.
Right now, right here. Would you do it for us?
For sure.
Let's do this.
Inhliziyo yam thatha naluthando lolwakho thatha nantsi inhliziyo yam suyiphathe njengeqanda sithandwa ndithi ngabo ndiyasithandela
from Vusi Nova, which is available on iTunes now. See you after the break.
Welcome back to the Weekend Edition. We are now joined by, I almost said Vusi.
After that performance.
Sia, and of course, Lox. Do they call you Lo? Lox? What's
Loki.
The
Loki?
No, I know your name is Loki. Yeah. But is that your nickname, Loki?
Well, my grandfather's name was Loki, but it's you spell it L-O-U-W-T-J-I-E.
What?
And then I got his name, and then I just, obviously, for the...
The limelight.
Sexier.
Yeah.
The business. Keep it on the down low. Loki, baby.
Now, we just had a really... You just had a crazy interview with Vusi. It was... It got quite deep in quite a few areas. I did not know that he had blown millions of rands on drugs and partying and stuff like that. And you were around at that time. That wasn't a low moment, was it? That would be considered
That's
a high
days.
Moment.
That's heydays. That's like,
But then the money, once the money is gone, and then it's the low. Low. Yeah.
You're in the low.
Have you guys experienced sort of low periods in your careers?
Oh, no, definitely. I think...
Well, you just started yesterday, so let me... No. You're 22.
I think it was my first year at fashion school where I just didn't fit into the school. My mom couldn't afford it, so I had to drop out. Didn't have any money or staying in Randburg with a place with no apartment, sleeping on the floor.
Damn.
Having to walk 10 kilometers to fashion school. So that time was a low moment. And that was a time where I almost left Joburg, actually, where I felt like, you know, this threaded man thing's not going to happen. My dream is over. And, you know, the opportunity that presented itself at that time came literally at that low moment where I was like, okay.
I'm packing up,
yeah,
I'm out of
literally
here.
Literally my way into the industry came at that time where I had given up. And I was actually literally at the bus station being like, okay, I'm leaving. When, you know, Dion Chang called and said, listen, do you want to come intern and work with me? Literally, I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for that exact call 5 minutes before my bus to Cape Town.
Lady luck.
And did you cry like Khanyi when you got that call?
No, I sort of was like... Yes, I'm in the door and I'm never getting out.
Yeah, wow.
Yeah.
Wow. And for you, Loki?
Yeah, well, I think there's a lot of stuff. I mean, my story is obviously, I mean, not that intense. I think after school, probably my album, first single, this is going to sound weird.
So this is post-Essay's Got Talent. This is post like, working with Jack Parra.
I released...
The Antwoord. Yeah,
I released a song out of nowhere before I even had plans to do the album, and the album only released 2 years, 3 years after that song dropped, and it turned out that was the biggest song of the album.
Shucks.
Wow. So you can imagine dropping your single of the album, and That was the heat. I mean, and people asking for your album, and you have no album.
Wow.
Yeah.
But isn't that the sort of modern day story now? Like people release singles,
yeah.
And then they come really fast. They go in the lab for 2 weeks and record an album.
But you need material to play shows. You need a 45-minute set. You need an album.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If they buy it or not, you still need material to do at live shows because you kind of make your money off gigs and shows. You know.
Right.
So imagine that you're sitting there, the song like blew up, and then releasing the album, and you're like, if people ask you for an album, you're like, no, I don't have an album, but I'm working on it, and it took 3 years to finish.
Well, you're missing out on gigs, and
I would have taken before. I would have taken the gigs. I mean, I remember guys
I did, but it's just weird, kind of rocking
empty.
Up, and you wanna play you wanna play your own stuff, you wanna sing your own songs, and then it's
dude,
like
you get that money. I remember when Future came out, he only had the same damn time or whatever the name of the song was, and he toured on that one song, irrespective. But okay, that's incredible.
Yeah,
wow.
So that I must say, I still think about that. I'm like, oh,
cringe.
No, but I love what you say. By saying you should have taken it and hope that luck helps you. A lot of people think most people in the industry are lucky. I mean, a few people could also say, yo, Khanyi was lucky, you know, it wasn't about talent to begin with and stuff like that. But for me, luck is only 2% in the whole thing. Because
I disagree.
I'm telling you.
I think luck is a much bigger component.
No, it isn't. Because after the luck, you need to back it up. to stay in. I mean, you could get in, but it's
you can
the
be
stay.
Like it for so long
yeah,
until
you
people
can't
see right through it.
Yes,
you know. And how many people? I mean, I was saying to you earlier off camera, I was like, I'm so incredibly honored to be on the show because you guys have been around for a very long time, and you now just landed a new show.
Yeah.
And I'm like, how many people in your era when you started are still here today in the same industry as you guys? You know, that just shows that luck can only take you so far.
Yeah.
And, but both of you are here because of the consistency and the hard work. And I mean, she's doing a new show tomorrow. So
I like the way he thinks we're from the same era. I'm from the era before hers. But yeah.
No, but you've always been like the prefect.
Have I?
Yeah, just looking after us younguns. Yeah. You know?
But I think luck does play. I mean, In the music industry, it does play a role. People try to define what a hit song is.
Exactly, and you never know.
There's no formula. It can be, you know, a great song with great lyrics.
No, the people
perfect
choose.
Song structure.
And, no, the people yeah.
But it's right time, right person, right time.
No, yeah. But Loki, have you had a good song that people choose and they like? Then you go see the person on stage. That's luck, right? And on stage, they disappoint you. You get people like that,
yeah,
where
sure.
we choose the song, but after that, you need to still perform and sell it to me yeah. even more, sell me the whole package. And once I get there, I won't say names, but there once was a girl who made a hit song, claimed that someone else stole it, and when we went to go... When we went
you know,
to,
eh?
When you see on stage and you're like... And it's a powerful song, but once right. you see on stage, you're like, no, it's that's not
yeah.
her. That can't be her.
Yeah.
So,
and, I mean, I want to throw a spanner in the works. Like, I don't believe in luck, but I believe in the hard work and then the execution that comes afterwards. So, you, like, I read a book by Malcolm Gladwell. I'm called Outliers. The 10th, there's a rule called 10,000 hours, where there's a period in a career where you're constantly working and not getting anything, and you're
right.
not getting anywhere. Then that one opportunity comes along, and it just seems like everything is happening at once. Like, I'm going through that stage where I'm getting the interviews, I'm getting the gigs, I'm getting the jobs, but people forget, but people think that that's luck. But it's not luck. It's because you've done so much work before that now it's just the execution now. You know, it's just now it's like God is giving you the gifts you've been wanting and
but he's
working
got a different
towards.
Problem. So it takes him 3 years to do an album.
So please find
the door
a
can
way.
Open
yeah.
and he's just never ready.
Well, that's why I need
way.
To write for other people.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. We were talking about that. You said that it's a lot harder for you to write material for yourself. Mm. You're a lot more harder.
Yeah, definitely.
But for other people, it's much easier to just churn out stuff and because.
Yeah, because I can kind of see their... I go through their albums and stuff, and I see their style, and it needs this, it needs this. And yeah, it's just a lot easier. I don't know why. For me, thinking about I'm going to be... And the other thing is I write about stuff. A lot of the stuff actually happened. It's not stories that I make up or get from movies.
Yeah. Mm.
So those things need to happen before the songs happen, you know?
Usually say artists never finish, they walk away.
Yeah.
Yes.
You need to walk away. That's when they're like, just walk away, because you keep changing stuff in the studio.
Yeah.
So you get to a point where your producer's like, just walk away. They never finish, they just
You've
walk away.
You've actually done music.
Yeah.
Currently doing music.
Oh,
you're
currently
well.
Doing, are you doing an album?
No, not an album, but music. I've got a lot of music.
And
really?
I remember you played
I've
me a
got,
snippet. That's going to be quite huge. All right.
How many songs have you recorded today that are on the shelf?
I've got 15 songs now.
15. And you're doing an album.
Not an album. I've got music. I'll probably pull in a Nasty C and just drop every week, because that boy drops every week and it's all hits.
Yeah.
That's what he does, yeah.
Because
we're past the era of dropping an album. You could drop singles and people just catch on and let them download them and that's it.
Right. Very cool, man.
Yeah.
And Vusi was very open about his issues with substance abuse and things like that. In your line, in music, definitely, substance abuse is quite heavy. Have you encountered that? Have you had to kind of protect yourself?
I think... in today's industry, it's become, I think I skipped the rock star thing. There was a time where people were selling like, I don't know, hundred thousands of copies of physical albums.
Right.
And now it's gotten to a point where there's no time to like mess around with stuff like that and to be professional, you know. I can't even imagine, going to play, like doing a performance, and then...
And you're tripping.
Yeah, tripping, and afterwards, or the next day, and you're like out for a day on...
Yeah.
You can't
and
get up.
And the older you get, have you noticed, it takes longer to get out of anything.
Yeah. I just can't imagine to do what I'm doing now and even try drugs at all.
Right.
There's no, flying, playing a show, getting on the plane the next day, arriving in Cape Town, go to the studio, doing emails. It's doing social, creating content, writing songs. Mm. Because I manage myself at the moment.
Yeah.
So that's like, that's all that'd label's job on its on its own, you know? Mm. It's tough. But I love it. Yeah.
And you see it to cut better, to see better.
I mean, you're the young guy here. You must be seeing it all is happening now.
I think generally for me is that the way I look at my life and the way that I look at myself, I feel like I'm guided by inner light. That guides me in whatever I do. To be young and be where I am today is not a right, it's a privilege and an honor. Yeah. And, you know, I look at people like Elon Musk, I look at your Oprahs, that's where I want to be one day. I look at your Bill Gates. I want to take fashion to that level. I want to be Africa's first fashion entrepreneur that makes billions, you know? Mm. And my aim is to be a billionaire by the age of 30. So I don't have time to be messing around with drugs right now, you know, I just don't have the capacity. But I mean, also, I work with everyone in the music industry, from rappers to everything. And, you know, luckily for me, people have respected me enough not to do drugs in front of me, actually. You know, the only thing I've seen is excessive consumption of alcohol. But in terms of drugs, hardcore drugs, no, I haven't actually been that exposed to it. I haven't had, been in a room where I'm like, whoa, what's going on here? I think people just generally respect my space. I'm generally around people who are real, you know?
Yeah.
So, and I'm one of those people, I really respect what I do. Just because I style a rapper doesn't mean I'm gonna go party with the rapper. There's a professional relationship there. I don't cross those boundaries.
Gotcha.
Just because I style someone doesn't mean now we're best mates and we're best friends. I do the job and I leave.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not gonna party, I'm not gonna, you know, be in that scene. I think that's what keeps me sane and keeps me in my own lane.
Right. I want to talk about a craze that's been happening all around the world. It just happened like a few weeks back. This Pokemon thing. Have any of you played Pokemon?
Hey, guys.
Pokemon Go.
I haven't played it, but I've seen the videos and I've seen the craziness.
I've seen the videos. I don't get it. You haven't touched it?
No, you just explained it to me.
I messed around with it yesterday because my friends were like, yo, dude. No, because it's so funny. I was having dinner with my friends. And then they're on their phones, they're like, yo, dude, did you catch it? Did you catch it? I'm like, what are you talking about? They're like, we just found a Pokemon. I'm like, wait, they're like, it's on your pizza. I'm like, what? I don't see it. So I'm like, hey, man, takato, baloyiwe, or being possessed. They're like, no, look at the phone. And I look at the phone, there's literally like a Pokemon literally on my pizza. It's a virtual reality game.
And how do you catch it?
And the whole thing is that, like, wherever you are in an area, it gives you notifications. There's a Pokemon chilling on that chair, and then literally you must go and capture it. And
so you're playing against the rest of the world?
Yeah. In a sense, yeah. Yes, but it's more about there's different levels in the game. And there's different levels in the game. And the more Pokemons you capture, the more you train. I mean, you get to a coach level where you get to coach others on how to catch Pokemons. And then, you get life points. It's quite crazy. And literally, a friend of mine the other day, his sister, shit on Facebook, Tyler, mom just told me you took the car to find Pokemons. Please don't tell me this is true. And then he replied saying, I need to get them all. It's like people are taking trips to find this thing. It's crazy.
People have been getting robbed and mugged while searching for Pokemons and things like that.
I have a child, and this is scary. If our kids are going to be wandering off trying to find something that's not real or virtual, you know, and these people that create these things, I swear, one day you're going to open a portal and you're going to let in funny things.
Yeah.
You know, honestly, we are tempering with funny. We're now going into the second layer, I'm worried.
And apparently, there was a controversy with the game because apparently everyone that downloaded it in its first batch, there was a glitch in the system that the software could capture, like, your data on your phone, your emails and everything.
Yeah.
And that was quite a big thing. So anyone who has downloaded the game the last month,
they have everything. Up a door
and, like, even like
closed.
With Snapchat now, apparently the whole face recognition, like, with the whole face...
Yourself into a
apparently
database.
Apparently it's a database of face recognition. Like, it's lit right now.
Yeah.
Why don't we leave Earth and just go live on Pluto? Let's leave this place. I can't.
There's a huge conspiracy that the game is also being used to map people's surroundings and things like that. So wow. That's pretty crazy. But all right, look, listen, we want to find out from you guys if you've played the game, your experiences with it. Make sure you hit us up on social media. You can find us on Facebook. We are Weekend Edition on Facebook. And then on Twitter and Instagram, it's The Weekend on 3. We'll be back just after this. Welcome back to the Weekend Edition. I'm here with the girls, the lovely ladies, and we're still making stuff. Guys, by the way, thank you so much for all the social media interaction. Once again, it's Weekend Edition on Facebook and The Weekend on 3 on Instagram and Twitter. Thank you so much. So what are we doing now, Suanne?
You know, when we're keeping it sexy, I think we're going to have something a little bit sweet. So that's what this
bit
is all about. And I think, you know, you say the word flapjacks and people just get excited.
Yes. Yeah, exactly.
Everyone, kids, adults, it makes us happy. So we're going to be doing some ricotta flapjacks, which is just a bit of a different take on it.
Okay.
So we're using some ricotta cheese, which we're going to put into the flapjacks. It's also, again, this is really simple to make, and it's just upping it.
But what's
notch.
In the bowl?
In the bowl, we've got flour at the moment, and we have got some baking powder because we want them to puff up slightly and rise because we're making a flapjack cake.
Mm. Okay.
That's gonna be the pretty bit.
It's getting more and more complex.
Yeah, I was like, how do I keep it sounding simple? But it is. So flour, we've got our baking powder. We have got 2 tablespoons of caster sugar. We still need that little bit of sweet into the mixture. This is our ricotta cheese. So that beautiful crumbly white cheese, which was a big thing in our house growing up. I used to love this with mayo.
Has it got a strong cheese flavor?
It's light, actually, okay. which I think is really lovely about it. So in goes our ricotta cheese. We've got 50 mils of melted butter, because everything's better with butter.
Nice. Already, can you smell it?
You're just smelling the start of the cooking process.
What's in the pan, by the way?
So we've just got some non-stick cooking spray.
She's great. You're smelling the
plan. I mean, it is on some of it right now.
And then we've got our...
just smelling.
And then that's just our milk. So we've also got milk as what's going to keep this nice and loose.
He's clearly not used to home cooking, eh?
I think he's just hungry.
Just the smell of burning
No, but I said the same thing. I was like, it smells good, whatever it is.
So we just want to get this into a batter. Obviously, it's not going to be 100% smooth because of that ricotta cheese, but that's what we want. So we just want to work it around. And then I've made some already, as you may have seen. And if your mixture's looking like this, you want to add a little bit more milk. So you're looking at 125 mils to 150 mils of milk. So
that's what I was going to say. Isn't pancake batter usually pretty runny? I mean, aren't you supposed to sort of pour it in?
Well, usually it's a cup of flour, a cup of milk. So it is quite runny. And then obviously I still need to add egg. I just want to do that.
Okay.
And then your egg's also going to help to bind.
All right.
And it's also obviously going to add a degree of liquidity.
Yeah.
I'm not, is that a word? Yeah,
viscosity out of it, maybe.
Sounded cool, hey? Yeah. So one large egg usually. These are quite tiny. You could actually afford to add 2. So just have a look at the size of your little eggs. Yeah, in this case, the little eggs.
Right.
But in they go, and we work this through, and this will be the perfect consistency. So you'll see it'll loosen up.
Yeah, it is, yeah.
Mm. Our pan's nice and hot. Again, this is something that's very cool to do with the kids at home. Kids love making flapjacks. Just obviously, if the kids are washing, let mom do the heat bit.
And then you cook them very slowly, obviously,
You cook
right?
them slowly. So you get your pan up to high heat, and then you turn down.
My biggest frustration is I never have a pan big enough to do like 8 at the same time, because I like to serve my food hot. And how can you do that with a traditional stove?
Well, you know what, with flapjacks like this, and it's actually a great question, is because they are slightly thicker, you want to keep them warm in the oven, and that'll also finish the cooking process. So once you put them on a baking sheet and in like an oven that's like 50 degrees, and it's just gonna finish it off. It's gonna keep it warm. If you're using a pan that's slightly bigger than this, do 2 of them, because you'll see it's not a big size. You literally are looking at kind of, and let's hope it's, this is not a very big spoon, but it's pretty much like a heaped tablespoon.
Yeah.
Gonna get it all in, and then you literally will work it, if you don't have a cutter that shapes it, work it into a round. It's 1 spoon. So if you've got a bigger nonstick pan, you can actually probably even possibly do up to 3 of them
Yeah, and that's going to cook super slow,
and
right?
That's cook
you have
slowly.
To just watch it without falling
You've
asleep.
You've got to watch it and you'll see.
Yeah, right?
You see, I would never fall asleep with this.
Because you love cooking, right?
But watch the little bubbles at the end, and, yeah. and once they start to move into the center, we know that we're ready to flip. But because I know we've got some hungry guests on the couch over
on the
there,
other side.
On the other side.
We made these in advance. How we long did this take you to make you these many, with a pan like this?
With a pan that size, yeah. 20 minutes.
20 minutes, okay.
I'm being honest, 20
right,
minutes.
Gotcha,
so,
gotcha,
I mean,
yeah,
so we can do quicker. What you can do, which I want to show you, is you can actually pop the blueberries in while they're cooking, which is quite cool. But we've got blueberries in some of them, and this is why we're going to call it a cake, because this is how we start. We're going to take our fresh blueberries, which we want to put on the top. We want to put it also around the sides. This is really just finish it off. And then again, if you've got honey at home, Fynbos honey will work well with this. Use Fynbos honey, but
right.
I'm just feeling all maple-y today, so.
Go ahead and feel maple-y, girl.
This is what I want to do.
Would I not flip this now?
You can flip it now, you can.
Do you see
how he wanted to get
yes.
in there?
And he wants to do it. Ooh.
He's definitely
yeah.
a cook, hey?
Khanyi's
he's so excited. So
Khanyi's not even.
Khanyi's like, I'm just helping Sue clean on here. And then a dusting of icing
That's,
sugar on top.
That is
our
one serving
pancakes.
For one person.
No, definitely not a serving for one person.
How do you share that?
You do.
How do you slice
the joy
it and share
is
it?
In this becoming a mess when you serve it. It only looks sexy for about this
so like
of time.
Maybe
so what you're
going to
do, you would actually slice.
Right.
You'd
okay.
probably even slice into four. And when you guys get to eat this all a little bit later, it's about everyone digging in and having spoonfuls and mopping
I
up the
I can see me and Khanyi
stir.
Just like digging into it
like
and just looking into each other's eyes and just like losing.
Like,
yeah.
I don't know what's going on in this
it
kitchen
like
today.
Our,
it's been
yeah.
getting hot and it's not just the string over here.
Okay.
So that is as simple as it is. You were saying how many
and
does
that
serve?
That's the finished product, right?
It looks
if you've
beautiful.
Got more time and you want to make a bigger cake, simply just make bigger ones. You know, if you know, hey man, there are four of us for
I
breakfast
love
or six.
Mega
make
pancakes,
big ones,
yeah.
pile that thing up. And it really is quite a showstopper if you're having a bit of a party and it's something different to a normal cake. You've got the savory of the ricotta, you've got the maple syrup, you've got the tartness of the blueberry. So in one bite.
All right, so we're gonna try and have a little bit of fun. We're gonna play a new game. We've never done this before. It's called Vat Ini Pap. All right. Which basically means what's in the breakfast bowl, right?
Yep.
Both of you have some breakfast. Not only do you have breakfast, you have breakfast stuffed with little trinkets. You might want to pour that into your bowl. And the idea of the game is to see who can guess the most items first. Each of you have five items mixed in with your pop. And we're going to give you a chance to pull it out and give the other person a chance to guess what's in there. All right, you guys ready?
I suck at this.
You suck at this?
Oh, gosh.
All right, so I guess both of you can pull out an item. And Vusi, since you are our guest, you get to go first by giving Khanyi the first chance to guess.
Okay, here goes nothing.
You can just you can go ahead and put it in here.
Okay, so Khanyi, when you put makeup on, right?
Yeah.
I think it's the last thing they put on. Okay, you've actually got it on right now.
Yeah, what do you
there's
think
it
is?
There's one for the ladies, and then there's a unisex one as well. So what do you think it is?
Lebice?
There
yeah,
you go. Thank you.
Wow, okay, you gave it away. That was easy. All right, Khanyi, pull out something.
You usually put it on a bunch of keys. It has.
Keyring. Ah, this is too easy. Either that or you guys are too smart. Why don't you close this? Okay.
Okay.
There we go.
So musicians, right? Never take they don't take coffee. What do they take with honey and lemon? So if it's not coffee, it's?
You don't have to think.
If it's not coffee, it's tea.
There you
exactly.
go.
Exactly, there you go.
Jeez. No, it's just scary. you can't open a bottle without it, either a beer bottle or a soft drink bottle.
Pardon?
You can't open a bottle without it.
A tin opener.
No, that's not a tin opener.
What is
what?
It? Oh, but it is, Joe.
It's not a tin opener, though, is it?
But what does it do?
The tin opener is the... That's the tin opener.
Oh, my gosh. Hey, guys, you open bottles with it. Open bottles with it.
A corkscrew. It's not a corkscrew.
Hey, Chief, you
open what?
You open bottles with it.
You open bottles with it?
Yes. Yeah. Oh, soft drink little bottles. Those little baby
a
bottles.
A tin opener.
A dumpy.
A tin
this,
opener.
This.
It's not a tin opener.
Okay, Vusi, it's your turn.
You didn't get this. All right, try it. You continue.
Okay. You asked me this earlier on about a bunch of keys. What do you use to hold them together?
It's a key ring.
There you go. But it's a nice key ring. What is on that?
All right, my one is...
Is that a helicopter?
That's a bike.
It's a mini moped.
Are we doing more?
Yes, one more. Okay. It usually comes in blocks. It's got
But I think Kanye's won. She's gotten what? Three.
I've got
first
three
of three.
So
who guessed the first of three? That's first of three. Yeah, well, give it up for our winner. Vusi Pop, first time ever played here. Now, guys, we're going to take a short break. We'll be back with more of the Weekend Edition. Keep that interaction going on social media. We can be found on Facebook, Weekend Edition. On Instagram and Twitter, we are The Weekend on 3. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Weekend Edition. This is a Saturday morning, and we always have a great, great performance. Today, we got two great performers that are collaborating together to perform a song originally performed by the Bee Gees. It's called To Love Somebody. Here's Vusi Nova and Loki Rothman.
There's a love, a certain kind of love that's never shown me. I want my life to be lived with you, lived with you. There's a way everybody says to do each and every little thing, yeah. But what good does it bring if I ain't got you? Whoa, yeah, you don't know what it's like, baby. You don't know what it's like to love somebody, to love somebody the way I love you, baby. You don't know what it's like. Baby, you don't know what it's like to love somebody, to love somebody the way I love you.
Wow. Fantastic impromptu performance there. Thank you to Vusi Nova and Loki Rothman. All our guests, Suan, Ellen, who prepared this wonderful meal, Daniel Ting Chong, who you saw earlier this morning, that wonderful designer, and of course, Sia, thank you for coming to join
thank
us, man.
So yeah, great
We're
breakfast.
Looking forward to you doing great things, becoming that billionaire as promised. Guys, until tomorrow.
Sunday.
We're out of here.